Hello and welcome. In today's video, we're going to explore the latest updates from NetherSX2, which brought important improvements for several games and now offers two separate versions tailored for different types of devices. We'll also talk about a new PCSX2 project that introduces a build with recompilers capable of translating x86 instructions to ARM64. And finally, we'll take a look at Aorus, a new emulator still in its early stages, but one that's already piquing the interest of the emulation community. Let's start with the Android version of PCSX2 that now includes x86 to ARM64 recompilers. This new approach is still in the early stages, but it stands out because it's based on the Android build of PCSX2 and uses a recompiler that directly translates x86 instructions to ARM64. It's important to note that this method requires more processing power, unlike NetherSX2, which was built from the ground up for ARM64 and is therefore lighter, more battery efficient, and performs better on most devices. The idea behind this new build is mainly for testing and reference purposes, but even so, we got a few surprises during testing. On the project's Discord, developer Trixarian, the same dev behind NetherSX2, compiled this build expecting it not to run anything. However, he was surprised to see some games working. Three gameplay clips were shared by members of the community, and we're going to quickly analyze them. The first one is from a NASCAR game, recorded by a user named Yua. The game suffers from audio issues, stuttering, and low performance, but since we don't have a direct comparison with how it runs on NetherSX2, it's hard to make a proper assessment. The second gameplay is from Devil May Cry 3, captured by user Maris. Although the game starts in a small area, performance was pretty solid, hitting 60 FPS most of the time. However, shader compilation is noticeably slow, something that's nearly non-existent on NetherSX2. The third video, also from Maris, shows Sly 2, Band of Thieves. Anyone familiar with this title knows it's a tough game to emulate stably. Here, despite being able to get in-game, the performance is slow and full of stuttering. This really highlights how experimental the project still is. It's also worth mentioning that on-screen controls are poorly placed, and the UI is extremely basic. In addition, the emulator seems to be running in software mode with native resolution, which further limits performance. If you want to follow development closely, you can check out the project's GitHub and download the compiled version that's been shared there. Now let's talk about Aorus, another emulator that's even more in its infancy but is already starting to draw some attention. Aorus is a PlayStation 2 emulator being developed for Windows, macOS, and Linux, and according to the devs, it's the result of around 8 months of work. At this point, it can reach the start screen of most games, but only a handful of 2D titles actually get to playable gameplay. The emulator doesn't yet have a recompiler for the PS2's main processors, nor does it support hardware-accelerated recompilation. It also needs to implement full support for the Dev9 module, used for network features, as well as improved peripheral support like the Gunkon, microphone, keyboard, and mouse. Even with all these challenges, if Aorus is well-developed, it could become a viable alternative in the future, maybe even surpassing projects like Play. That's because, despite how complete PCSX2 is, it still struggles with compatibility for certain niche titles. If you want to buy original games while saving a lot, check out Instant Gaming, the digital store that sells games for various platforms, such as PC, PlayStation, Xbox, and Nintendo Switch. Get games of all genres with discounts of up to 95%. You'll also find a variety of gift cards and credits for other services. You can pay for your order through your credit card on a website with a 4.7 rating on Trustpilot. You're buying games directly from Instant Gaming, not from other retailers. If you encounter any issues, Instant Gaming offers 24/7 support. And this month, Instant Gaming is offering a great discount on the newly released Monster Hunter Wilds, with up to 51% off, ensuring the lowest historical price for the game. Check out the price comparison with Steam's pricing. What are you waiting for to save? Links in the description. Before we continue with the rest of the video, don't forget to leave a like if you enjoy staying up to date with everything happening in the emulation scene. And if this is your first time here on the channel, consider subscribing so you don't miss any content like this. Now let's talk about the cherry on top. NetherSX2 just got two new versions. That's right, two fresh builds. These latest updates brought improvements to the texture dumping system, updated widescreen and no interlacing patches, a new Russian translation, a better UI, with larger cover art, and tweaks to the on-screen control layout. The game DB has been updated, which means better automatic compatibility and improved performance in many titles. The controller DB was also refreshed, allowing new controllers to be recognized without needing manual setup. Just remember to save your progress to the memory card before updating, as save states might not be compatible between versions. Currently, There are two main builds available, one based on version 3668, which performs better on lower-end devices, and version 4248, which includes more bug fixes but demands more from your hardware. And like I mentioned earlier, save states aren't compatible between them. For example, version 4248 includes major graphical fixes for games like Black, Ace Combat, and Jak and Daxter, among others that previously had visual glitches. On the other hand, games running on the Snowblind engine, like Baldur's Gate, Dark Alliance, Champions, Justice League Heroes, still have serious issues in 3668, so you'll definitely want to use 4248 for those. Also, be aware that newer texture packs, created in 2024 or later, won't work with NetherSX2. That's because PCSX2 changed how texture file names are structured, and now automatically renames old files, breaking compatibility. Some retro achievements were also affected, but the team is already working on a fix. As I promised in last week's emulation news video, I ran tests on a wide variety of games, especially those reported to have issues. All tests were conducted using version 4248, which received the most improvements. Gameplay footage was captured with an external video card, so there was no performance loss due to screen recording software. Let's start with the Ace Combat series. I tested Ace Combat 4, which used to have major performance and texture issues. Now, the gameplay is nearly perfect. Most performance problems are gone, and I was even able to bump up the resolution. The only minor issue that remains is with sunlight rendering, some small visual artifacts, but they don't affect gameplay. Next, I tested Baldur's Gate Dark Alliance 2, which had been reported as fixed. However, I still ran into slowdown in certain map areas and even some GPU crashes, especially inside the tavern. In contrast, Champions, Return to Arms, which runs on the same engine, performed much better. I played for over an hour without any issues. Keep in mind this game even struggles to run via USB on a real PlayStation 2 using OPL. Even in high-res and heavy combat scenes, performance stayed stable. That said, since the original port isn't very optimized, overclocking the emulated CPU is recommended for best results. Crash Bandicoot. The Wrath of Cortex unfortunately regressed. Or maybe it just runs better in version 3668. On the title screens, there are fog rendering issues when using the hardware renderer. You can switch to the software renderer, but in more advanced lighting areas, the game may slow down significantly. Final Fantasy VII Dirge or Cerberus, which also used to suffer from extreme slowdown, is now playable in several segments. However, all HUD text and menu elements are broken, making it impossible to identify items or navigate menus, which kills the gameplay experience. I was also able to run one of the most visually demanding games on the system, Gran Turismo 4. Unlike other titles I tested at 3.5x resolution, I had to lower it to 2.5x to avoid lag. So if you experience stuttering or crashes, try reducing the resolution. This game is GPU heavy. Jak and Daxter was another series reportedly improved. I tested the first game and found that vertex explosions still occur, especially with shadows, and some character eyes still don't render correctly. These visual bugs remain, but overall, the game is now playable. Finally, I tested the classic Resident Evil 4, a must-play for many fans. The game maintained a stable 30 FPS, as it was designed to, and I didn't encounter any performance or graphical issues during my test session. Overall, based on the testing I've done, this emulator has seen meaningful improvements across several titles. Sure, there are still games that run poorly, but considering the lack of official documentation or original source code, these changes are definitely a step in the right direction, especially for those looking to emulate PS2 games on Android. As always, links to everything mentioned in the video are in the description, including the cooler I used and some controller suggestions for you to check out. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. This battle is about to explode. Fight!